I'm the director of programs at International Alert, and I won't take up too much of your time because you haven't come to listen to me. But I'd just like to say assalamu alaikum and welcome to everyone who's here. This is our first peace talks. We have a series called Peace Talks, which are opportunities to share knowledge and ideas about specific conflicts or specific peace or peacebuilding issues. And this is the first one of the year. Thank you all for coming. This one is building peace from the bottom up in Syria. Community-based peacebuilding from Aleppo to London. All eyes are on the, unfortunately, what are unfortunately perennially frustrating high-level talks and processes in regards to Syria. And it is clear that without that high-level international success, it's going to be very difficult for Syrians to emerge from this war. And we know that that might still take But that doesn't mean that we have to wait until those high-level peace builders and peace makers get their act together in building peace. But today we're here to explore some of the civil society initiatives which people are already working on. In some respects, people are leading the way in rebuilding communities which have been torn apart by this war, simply looking at education programs, and asking what can be learned from them about how we can better support Syrians, whether they're in Syria or outside Syria, even the Syrians, refugees who are here in Western Europe and the UK. This is it's really to have an interesting discussion and to hear what our panelists have to say, and you'll have the chance to offer your ideas and ask questions too. But it's also the opportunity for us to launch this new report, Why Young Syrians Chose to Fight, Vulnerability and Resistance to Recruitment by Violent Extremist Groups in Syria. I think it's a really important report. I think probably most of the people here are intelligent and knowledgeable to know that the way, the simplistic way in which Syria is reported here is often far too shallow. But this report gives more information about why people make choices to join armed groups. And one of the interesting things about it is it's not necessarily because of what they believe is the circumstances in which they find themselves. So if you haven't got a copy already, we have some here, you can pick up the report, and it's also available on our website. Tell your friends about it and your colleagues about it. It's really an interesting set of findings here. The way these peace talks work is that there'll be a chaired discussion, and I will introduce the chair and the panelists in a moment, until about 8:30, and that will include the discussion by the people on the stage, and then you'll have an opportunity to ask questions from your ideas as well. Then we hope you'll stay after that, because around 8:30, when we leave this room, there will be canapés and drinks and canapés and a Middle Eastern fusion canapé in the reception in the, just outside. So you won't be allowed to leave unless you're in a real rush. That'll be a chance
should
to
I get
talk
one?
More with people on stage.
Because I'm going to get mine.
If you're interested in social media, we're using the hashtag Peace Talks for this. Hashtag Peace Talks. And you can tag international words if you
want to. I want to tell you to shut up. Okay.
So with that, let me introduce you to our distinguished panel. So chairing the panel this evening is Rachel Sharby, a freelance journalist and author who's written extensively about the Middle East by a number of newspapers, including some here, The Guardian, Times, Al Jazeera and The Independent. And then joining Rachel on the panel, we have Amaf Yusuf, let me read that properly here. Amaf Yusuf, Refugee Support Coordinator at Rethink Rebuild Society, great name for a great organisation. So Rethink Rebuild Society are a community organisation formed in Manchester at the start of the Syria uprising in 2012, and they work towards improving the lives of Syrians in Manchester and helping them to become positively established in society. And then next time up, we have Anna Farina, who's head of the London office of Syria Relief. Syria Relief is another UK-based charity that aims to relieve suffering and build a future in Syria, very active in Syria, providing emergency medical aid. Now they have a range of other programs to support Syrians' needs, focusing on key areas such as education, food security, water sanitation, and orphan support. I ran a marathon for Syria Relief last year, And then Caroline Brooks, our own Caroline Brooks from International Alert, who is our Syria Projects Manager. She manages the Alert's Peace Education Programme and is one of the lead authors. In fact, it was a Herculean task, I think, to produce this report by this deadline, so well done, project. Caroline. There was one other person who was supposed to come, who was Abir Haji Ibrahim, but he had, this is such a familiar problem with these kinds of talks, we weren't able to get the visa for Abir to join us on the panel. So shame that we couldn't have the complete panel, but I think we will do very well with the panel we've got. So with that, over to you, Rachel.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and thank you all for joining us. I'm also not going to take up too much time because we have a panel here of people who each have very different insights. Not loud enough? Is it just you who thinks I'm not loud enough, or is it everyone else? Everyone else?
Thicker.
How about now? Yeah, that's much better, isn't it? Isn't it? No? Are we happy now? Okay. So we do have an excellent panel here, all of whom have very different insights and experiences to share. And I think, you know, as things get worse, as we hear of thousands of people being killed, you know, as we hear of hospitals being blown up and medical workers being killed and millions of refugees having to flee a country that they don't want to flee, it does become more important, I think, to hear about what is going on the ground, what grassroots efforts are being made, because when there is a peace, it will need a grassroots to sustain that peace, and it will need a civil society to enable that peace to have a chance of survival. So it's great that we have people here who hopefully can tell us more about what's going on, what is possible at this time, what could be done, and how we might be able to contribute. So let's please start engaging with that straight away. Caroline, you have introduced this incredible report looking at why young Syrians choose to fight. It is very different from a lot of reports that we've already seen, which tend to focus on why foreign fighters go to Syria and Iraq and join extremist groups. But this one is looking specifically at why young Syrians would engage with that. Could you tell us what your key findings were?
Sure. Yes, so just to sort of set the scene a little bit for you all in terms of the background of this report as well, and to draw up on some of the specific findings. International Alert has been looking into what is driving vulnerability amongst young Syrians to join violent extremist groups inside Syria, and to look at what we can do in terms of practical programming and interventions to reduce that vulnerability and then promote resilience in a holistic sense. And so we've been working with Syrian civil society organizations on the ground to do that. Specifically in terms of the report and the research and the findings, we conducted some original primary research inside Syria, mostly in Aleppo and Idlib, as well as in refugee communities in Lebanon and also in Turkey on some of the border towns. And we asked just over 300 Syrians, some of whom had been involved in armed groups, including ISIS and Jabhat al-Nusra, others who knew people who were with these groups, some who had been tempted to join but for various reasons decided not to, and also their peer networks, their families, their friends, social workers and teachers, so people who have real insight into the decision-making processes that young people are going through in Syria. In addition to that, we've been running, as both Phil and Rachel said, these peace education projects in these same locations, which has touched 7,000 children. And so the data that we've got out of working with these children as well has also been fed into the report to say, okay, what's driving vulnerability and resilience? And so taking all of these different data, all of this different data and all of this different evidence, four key things are emerging in terms of what's driving vulnerability. The first factor to mention is economic imperative. So as you'd all appreciate, the economic situation inside Syria is dire, and unemployment in some areas is around 90%. for a great many people, especially young men, joining an armed group and being involved in an extremist group is one of the only ways that to make a living. This is most strongly seen inside Syria, whereas with refugee communities, the economic imperative to join an armed group is much less pronounced, as you would expect. It's not a sort of key driver to return to Syria and engage with an armed group. Interestingly, it seems obviously that the Islamist groups and Jabhat al-Nusra in particular seems to be much better funded than some of the other groups which you might consider less extreme. And for those who are making decisions partly or mainly because of economic reasons, that's quite a big pull factor. The second main vulnerability factor to discuss is really the experience of extreme violence, loss, displacement, and trauma. There is an awful lot of anger and resentment specifically directed against the Assad regime for what is happening inside Syria. We found that a lot of the people that we spoke to see joining Jabhat al-Nusra, for example, and specifically this was mentioned in relation to Jabhat al-Nusra, as the most viable way to overthrow the regime. There was a sense that they are winning, that there is a desire to have somewhere to put all their grievance, which is... you know, has some sort of chance of having an impact of vengeance and revenge. And that was very strongly came through in the research. A lot of the people we spoke to reflected that. Part of that experience of violence and this trauma and loss is also attached to the complete breakdown of a normal social context. When you have this breakdown of a normal social context and this extreme experiences of violence, especially for young people who are at really key stages of their development, sort of cognitively, emotionally, in terms of identity and belonging, a lot of these armed groups are providing a cohesive group with a sense of purpose and an objective, which is greatly lacking in a lot of young people's lives. So that, again, was quite a strong driver. Where religion and ideology seems to come into this at this point is as a framework for making sense of what's going on and as a kind of narrative, a vocabulary, a way of seeing people's role in and seeing individuals seeing their role as part of something bigger. So it's a religious duty to fight. It is to protect my family, my home, my honor, and to die in service of something greater than me. The third main driver of vulnerability, so that one really relates to kind of the breakdown of normal social fabric and social ties, but the third one to mention is the deprivation of personal psychological needs. So the need to have autonomy and control over one's life, a sense of purpose and meaning to one's own sort of story and trajectory. This is compounding vulnerability inside Syria, but both in the refugee communities as well. So I'll give you a couple of examples from Lebanon. As many, not all of you will be aware, the situation for Syrian refugees inside Lebanon is very, very difficult. It's extreme marginalization and discrimination. They're excluded from working, no access to decent education, no accredited education. The sense of frustration and despair amongst young people is extreme. We found from a couple of our research respondents, or more than a couple in fact, that this sort of deprivation of personal significance is driving decision-making about joining ISIS and Jabhat al-Nusra. So, for example, one young man in southern Lebanon who had come across ISIS when he was inside Syria was considering returning to Syria to join them because he said they treated him like a human being with dignity. And for him, that was so lacking in his life that joining this group, which we all know to be, you know, extraordinarily violent and destructive, was a credible option for him. And it was driven in large part by his experience of being a refugee in Lebanon and being so marginalized. Others have told us that if I stay here in Lebanon, I die anyway. You know, it's sort of deaths, both metaphorically and perhaps also literally, I would rather be back in Syria fighting for a cause and die in the name of something greater than me. So the final vulnerability factor to talk about is the lack of education and opportunities to learn. This we found was driving vulnerability in a couple of ways. So inside Syria, the complete collapse of a decent education system means that hundreds of thousands of children are out of school. That creates a vulnerability in itself because you've removed part of that social structure and fabric, which for children, that sort of routine, that structure, that sense of belonging and purpose and just cognitive development that one gets when one goes to school is missing. Another way that sort of the collapse of education is driving vulnerability is that armed groups are providing alternative educations. So in the areas, for example, controlled by ISIS and governed by al-Nusra as well, they're providing an education, and for some, that's the only education they've received in the last 5 years. So you can quite clearly see how that would create a situation where there's a ready cohort of young people coming through who will be affiliated with either through their own will or through coercion or, to joining the ranks of these armed groups. In the refugee communities, really we found it's driving vulnerability because it's contributing to this sense of marginalization and this frustration, the fact that you don't see a future for yourself in where you are, and so you're looking for an alternative. So they're the four main vulnerability factors. It's just worth pointing out that they all overlap. Mm-hmm. There's no one thing that's sort of more important than the other. It's a combination of situational factors and an individual's own issues and own decision-making processes. And when we get into the conversation about programming and what that means for how we tackle it, we can perhaps go into how we do design programs to address the needs of the majority and also pinpoint the needs of very vulnerable people as well.
I mean, it sounds like incredibly important research and findings, and I should say now that I'm sure you all have lots of questions for our panelists, and there will be plenty of time for that. We'll make sure of that. But I suppose that would lead to the question of, how do you inoculate people? How do you stop people being vulnerable to those quite legitimate grievances and quite hard circumstances? How do you build resilience to that kind of vulnerability?
Yeah. So we found both through the research but also through the programming that we've been doing with partners that there are key elements that build vulnerability in build resilience in young people. So one of those factors is having positive, supportive social networks. So that's really talking about the influence of peer groups, of family, of positive community members, role models and mentors who act as guides for these young people, who are seen as the respected sources of authority, but they have an alternative message for these young people. For example, in one of our peace education centres, we had a young guy, a 17-year-old guy, who'd been going to the peace education sessions. He actually spoke to one of the facilitators, one of the mentors within the scheme, and said, "I've been contacted by my friend who left Lebanon last year to join ISIS, and I'm fed up with Lebanon. What should I do?" And so he was able, through this trust that he had in a safe place, in a secure setting with a trusted mentor, to talk through his decision-making process about whether he should return to Syria to join ISIS. That has happened on a few occasions within our peace education centres. We also know that this supportive social network is incredibly important because families are quite influential in pushing or pulling their youngsters to join or not. So that's one key aspect. Another is providing opportunities for livelihood. whilst our programming didn't specifically address livelihood, and I think that's something that Anna will talk in a bit more detail about, providing, like, creating opportunities for dignified, meaningful work, but also, you know, work that can keep bread on the table is another major thing to consider, especially obviously for those who are driven by mainly by economic reasons to join armed groups. Providing alternative sources for non-violent activism is also a crucial resilience factor. A lot of young people, especially displaced, in refugee communities, there's nowhere to channel their anger or their grievances. There's an awful lot of trauma that they're working through, but there's also an awful lot of energy that needs to be channeled somewhere. And what our programming does is provide avenues for doing that, but within a structure that is value-based. So it's based on tolerance for diversity. It's based on non-violent activism. It's based on taking perspectives of others who are different from you. It's also based on understanding one's own role within the conflict and how to understand the structural drivers of conflict and the conflict in Syria specifically. And then there's a psychosocial support, which we're providing through our partners on the ground in Syria and in the neighboring countries. And that's that works on the sort of social, emotional, mental resilience of children in terms of them personally, their relationships with others, and then their broader environment. And so we've really found that has made some children a lot less violent towards their siblings and towards their peers. We found that it's encouraged completely different behaviors within a lot of children who would otherwise, you know, be considered very vulnerable. And a lot of the parents have been feeding back that they've seen enormous changes in their children. They can't believe it's the same person. This is the child who was dressing up in military uniform. This one particular child, he lost his brother in Syria, profoundly affected him. He had received 6 months training with a military unit. He came to the peace education sessions in military uniform, talking about death and airstrikes and shelling. And then gradually, through involvement in these sessions, is kind of completely changing and becoming a child again, like the rest of us. So yeah. They're the kind of main drivers that we found of resilience.
Mm. I mean, it's really encouraging to hear that kind of transformation not only is possible, but actually has happened, that parents have seen it happen in their children. I'm sure we will come back to you more, Caroline, but it seems to me that there is a lot of overlap with the kind of work that your organization is engaged with, Anna, and also organizationally on the ground in Syria. Can you tell us a little bit about that, not least, how is that even possible at the moment?
Absolutely. So Syria Relief is an organization that, like most of the organization operating inside Syria, over the past year and a half realized that the way to help Syria changed. And we have to realize that the conflict has been dragged for such a long time that we can't keep distributing food baskets to people. We need to work on infrastructure. We need to work to a way to give these people dignity back and to let them rebuild their future with our help. So we can't impose a way to help. We need to give them the means to help themselves. And this fits very well with what Caroline said in terms of how can we give an alternative to Syrian people to not join the armed group. Because the children and the young people that are in Syria now and have been deprived from their childhood and their teenage are the people that will have to rebuild Syria in a few years' time. So we need to be very careful to give them the means to develop themselves in the way that gives them the chance to rebuild a peaceful country in the future. So what we are trying to do, as I think, I mean, a lot of organizations on the ground, is try to address these needs through three different programs. We are very focused on education, child protection, and livelihood. In education, we run 55 schools at the moment inside Syria. We give education to about 16,000 children. We run the Syrian national curriculum that most of the organizations are applying. The way we give children education is in a dignified way. We want them to realize that they are not lost, that they can build their skill, they can build their knowledge, they can rebuild their future. So in a few years' time, they will have received the education that they want to receive, and they will be able to have a degree, they will be able to build up a career when this war will be finished. They will be able to, if they want, to leave Syria and to find a job. So we want them to believe in themselves, to give them a purpose, because we notice that children and young adults that decide to join the armed group are people that don't have a purpose anymore, don't know what to do with their life. They feel completely useless, and the only way they feel they can realize themselves is through these armed groups. And obviously this is something very detrimental for the country. On child protection, we run 33 children-friendly space in Idlib and Aleppo. I mean, obviously, as you all know, the situation in Aleppo at the moment is very difficult. We have worked under difficult circumstances in the past as well. We had losses among our students and teachers, unfortunately. We try to work in the best security situation that we can, and if there are situations where the security is not good enough, we temporarily close school, we temporarily close children's center. We also send teachers to houses, and we group children in small group in flats or in community center to not have too many children in the same place, which could be dangerous. So we try to work with the situation. Where we can, we leave our infrastructure open. Where we cannot, we try to give education and support to children in other environment. So what we do in our children's center is mainly peace education. So we follow a curriculum that covers mainly six topics that are identity and assessment, dealing with emotion, peer relationship, relationship with adults, conflict and peace, and the future. So these six topics want to address and to help children that to overcome traumas and to deal with their antisocial behavior. We notice in many occasions that children that go through this program come out nicely and start being more open with their friends, start to make friends again that they haven't done for quite a long time. As it was said, they become children again. They start to interact with their peers, they start to interact with the teachers, and they talk to the teacher. It's very important to create trust between the teachers and the children, because if these children are approached by the armed groups, they have to trust their teachers and also their family to the point that they can go talk to them, explain what they've been asked to do, and so the dialogue can start. It's very important to keep the dialogue open. The children have to be informed, and they have to be able to receive enough information that they can make an informed decision of not joining this group. So it's very important to have an environment where teachers get down to the level of the children, talk to them, and establish this sense of community and peaceful network where children feel at home, feel understood, and feel they can share their emotion, they can share what they hear, they can share what they think. The third areas where we are working, and this is for young adults, is livelihood. Again, livelihood is an alternative for breadwinners, for men, for young men that don't have salaries, don't have a job, and don't know how to support their families. I mean, our aim in Syria Relief is to try to keep people and Syrian people inside Syria. We don't want an empty Syria in a few years' time, so we want to give their means in their country to support themselves. And the best way to do that is to try to offer them a job, to try to offer them a way to support their families in their community. In livelihood, we do a different number of projects. We run an agricultural project where we train farmers, so we distribute seeds. We help them to go through all the process of planting and use the vegetable and fruits for their own needs or to sell them to the community to create a sort of small business. We did a very nice project that is still ongoing where we trained young people to do different type of jobs. We train barbers, we train mechanics, and then we provide them with small kits to start their own business. So obviously this is a way for them to find dignity, not only income, but really to have a purpose in life, and that is not go and fight with an armed group. And the third part of the livelihood project that we ran recently was livestock, where we distributed animals. We help people to grow the animals. We distributed cheese machine to make cheese for the support of the family and into the community. So these are things that for us are very normal and they don't represent a big step. But for people that used to have a job, used to have an income, used to support their family with dignity, and all of a sudden found themselves in a situation where they have to rely upon organization to give them a food basket every month. I mean, for them to be able to go back and support themselves and support their family and to tell their children, I can receive some money, I can set up my own business and I can feed you through my work, it's very important. It gives them a lot. And we had many situations in which people came back to our offices inside Syria and reported the fact that they now have a purpose in life and they feel satisfied and they feel that through work they got their dignity back.
It's amazing to hear about that, and there's a million questions that I want to ask, but I won't. Just one though, I'm wondering, it's hard to imagine that this work is actually taking place and succeeding, especially in places like Aleppo at the moment. Are there efforts to undermine your work? Are there challenges that... Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, challenges are... I mean, security is a very, very big problem, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, we received information just a couple of days ago that our team in Aleppo, while they were distributing seeds for one of these city garden projects that we are running, they just end up in an area that was bombed, so they had to abandon the distribution and run away. So security is obviously a very important issue for us. They try to cope with that. Obviously it's very difficult to know where and when an area will be bombed.
Yeah.
So this is not really something can be predicted. In terms of, as I said, in terms of schools and children's center, especially when we have big schools with a lot of children, if the situation in the area becomes dangerous, we prefer to close the school for a few days, for weeks. We don't want to put the children and the teacher in danger. We had cases, I mean, we all know that there have been cases of school attacked and targeted, so obviously to concentrate many children or, for example, for hospital to concentrate doctor and patients can be a risk. So we had cases where we prefer to tell children to group in small groups in flats and have teachers going and leave books and exercise to do and then come back the day after just to keep the routine of school. Because, I mean, as Caroline said, especially for young children, the routine of going to school It's so important. It's probably the only piece of normality that these children have been seeing in the past few years. So we try to keep it alive even when the conditions are really bad, but we also don't want to compromise security for the children.
Thank you so much for bringing all that information to us, and I'm sure that we will have more to ask you later. Moving to you, Amaf, and the organization Rethink Rebuild Society, obviously part of the effort of building the peace is looking at refugees, of whom there have been far too many leaving Syria. It wouldn't be fair or true to say that Britain has, on a government level, has been particularly opening of its doors or its heart, but on a community, on a grassroots level, can you tell us a bit more about what that experience has been?
So I just want to stress on two points that were mentioned earlier about the religion influence with the radicals. I confirm what you're saying, because we get cases where people are saying, well, these radicals, a few years ago, they didn't know anything about religion. Mm-hmm. So the boys who are joining these groups, they're not religious. They're not religious boys. But the economic situation has played a big part, especially that usually Syrians used to work in Gulf countries or study in Europe. But when the conflict started, they weren't allowed to go outside their country. And then the neighboring countries, on a later stage, closed the borders. So people are being pushed into these groups, because if the borders are closed and no one is giving you a visa and you want to make a living, what you're going to do? This is your only option. This is on what you were saying. And basically on the feeling of dignity that Syria Relief was working on, this is what we experience from Syrian refugees here. Their main reason for depression and feeling helpless is because they're receiving support and not being able to support their families.
Yeah.
So this is this feeling of dignity is there, and it's a big part of what moves Syrian around the world. So here in the UK, on a governmental level, it wasn't that open, it wasn't that easy. Syrians didn't get any privilege other than the resettlement scheme that has started earlier. But then that's on the government level. Now, on the grassroots level, the British people have been quite supportive. A lot of people showed up to our offices offering help. A lot of British people, they're starting their own initiatives, trying to get together and work together to support refugees. The problem is, obviously, then I understood from British person that in the UK there's that problem where a lot of people want to do stuff, and they are doing stuff, but they're not coordinating together. So a lot of effort is being wasted with... Now, in Manchester, we got around 3-4 mentoring programs, and they're not working together. So that's when it comes to the grassroots organizations. But then people themselves, they are acting a lot. They are quite supportive for that. And then on later stage, As a grassroots organization, as an organization working with Syrian refugees, we start getting messages from different organizations that want to work with the Syrian groups and want to engage with the Syrian community. So bit by bit, it's taking time, but you can see that the things are getting more in a systematic way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of Syrian refugees that are in the UK, I mean, presumably there is a desire to maintain the connection, the family, the connection to the country, but at the same time develop some connection to this country as well. How does that work? Are you able to facilitate both, and what does that look like?
So basically, this is what we try to do at our organization. We try to provide some sort of background or some sort of a hub for Syrians to interact together and to interact with the local British community, to be productive in this community. So you can see people are trying, but there's a problem. Syrians are not living normal life. The conflict is still going. So if you tell a Syrian person that let's go to university to meet some students, or let's go somewhere to meet some people, they would prefer going to work on a second job just to support their families. So this is keeping the people away a bit from being fully...
Have the time even.
Exactly, they don't have the time. They don't have the time. If you send £1 to Syria, you can save a person. £1 can save a life. So these people, each Syrian is supporting a family or two. So that's why they... But then you can see a lot of them, they're going... Now when you're working, when you're productive, you are integrating, you're interacting, and these barriers are being broken. When you go to educational course, these barriers are being broken. And this is a tendency that Syrians have. The Syrians, not being a Syrian, but since we didn't have a benefit system in Syria, Syrians are used on being productive. Yeah. And here in the UK, it's a good place to be productive. There are always opportunities. So this is good. With these opportunities available and with the Syrians being productive, it's providing some sort of joint points where people can interact with the local community. Yeah. And you can see them integrating but maintaining their heritage. We're quite well-connected community. We're always, in a way, we're always together. You can always find Syrians supporting Syrians. Good example of that that I've seen the other day. There's a person who had just arrived to Manchester, isn't doing financially well. Someone was a few months before him, and the second person gave him half of what he has in his house. So if he has two spoons, he gave him one spoon. And that the second person met someone on the road, he's Syrian, and he noted that person is also suffering. So he told him, go to the Syrian community office, I'm gonna drop you something there. So he also split what he just got with the second person. So this is the sort of Syrian
it
community
sounds like there's
supporting
a parable here about splitting spoons, is there? No. But anyway, it's great to hear about what things look like on a grassroots level in the UK. Thank you, Amaf. Thank you, all three of you. I do want to open this up. These are talks, after all, and I'm sure that you all have plenty of questions for these three panelists. There are microphones, I hope. So if you could please just show your hand and a mic will come to you. First of all, this woman in the front. And please say who you are as well. Thank you.
My name is Carol Story. I'm a trustee on International Alert, and I'm also a photojournalist, and I work in conflict areas. A very interesting thing that you wrote about the community supporting community, which is taking responsibility, grassroots. So playing the devil's advocate, in doing that, does that also create a kind of an isolation if they are taking 2-3 jobs so they can support their family? And you say that they're integrating because of the people they're working with. What about the broader scope of what education could provide in terms of what is like to be living in England? What is the English history all about so that you have a wider integration, not just within the isolated? It's like a nation within a nation, what you're describing. It's not an integration because Syrians are depending on Syrians rather than going outside of it. So the question is, do you not think that can be a danger that they remain a nation within a nation, not looking at the broader opportunity of perhaps embracing what is English, but being also Syrian in terms of their souls?
So this is exactly what I was working on. When I came to this organization, I came as a refugee support coordinator, and I come from business background, so I'm used on analyzing stuff. So we noticed this. We noticed that, well, I don't want to have, in 5 years' time or 10 years, I don't to have a Syrian community well-connected but speaking only Arabic and just living in their ghettos. And this is what we're trying to work on. We waited for the government to have integration program, and then we realized it's going to take quite good time.
So we decided
starting our own. So we based a program on language as a first barrier. So we offer them ESOL classes, conversation classes, and IELTS courses so they can get into university. And then there's a mentoring program that we're working on where if someone want to work as, let's say, an Uber driver, we're going to try to match him with a British Uber driver. He's going to guide him through the way so he can start his career. This is one thing that's there. There are also volunteering opportunities, and we're encouraging Syrians not to volunteer in our organization, because if they do speak English, let them volunteer with a British organization. We also support them with jobs to do that. So this is the way that we're trying to break this barrier. As much as possible, we're intensively pushing the Syrian community to speak the language, learn it, make time, because we offer every once in a while, we push them, we tell them that if you don't build your language skills, you're gonna be stuck in a certain level. And then we try to push them into the British society more and more. The British society is being open, but then it's a process and it takes time. And a small organization wouldn't be able to solve a problem if it's not some sort of governmental body that's pushing that in a way.
Do you think it would help, just following on that important question?
Would it help if there was citizenship education about English, that they can go to night school and make an effort to learn and become more assimilated into the English way of life, and what the history is, and not just the king and the queen and all of that, just to give a broader scope rather than that much narrower. Learning English, of course, is survival, but outside of just learning English so you can get a job, how about learning in the broader scope? What is it about England that is important? What is the government like? What is the law like? What is the history? And when I say history, not just the numbers, I'm talking about the art and a whole broad spectrum of things. Would that not also enhance their integration and their appreciation of living in a country that they're finding a new freedom?
But to be fair, there's a lot of British-born people who wouldn't be able to answer all those things. So, but anyway.
Yeah, so basically... on that one, we do have some British volunteers who are working, taking people to galleries, try to explain to them. But if we want to be realistic, if someone was having to make a choice between saving a life back in Syria and knowing more about the country, he would save a life back there. Let's be realistic about this. But then this is happening in another route, through their kids, because the kids are going to schools, they are picking up the culture, and they're going back home in Manchester with Manchester accent, they're going back home. They're actually they are influencing their parents. And I had people coming from the most conservative cities in Syria expressing quite liberal and quite open ideas, and they're quite happy about sending their daughters to distant places to learn, and that happened through the kids. So the person who's making a living, it's going to be hard to convince him to go after work to night school, if I want to be realistic. But then through the kids, and we're talking about children and then college students, this is the way. At least this is how I see it.
Thank you so much for that. Are there any more? Oh, there's lots of hands up. Brilliant. There's a woman in the blue. Thank you. We'll get to you in a minute. Thanks.
Hi, my name's Olivia. I work in social protection at DFID. If I may, can I have two questions, and I'll keep them quite short?
All right, then.
I'm going with it.
Since you asked nicely.
Thank you. Caroline, this report, I think, is going to be an amazing... it is an amazing report. And I would like to know whether when you were interviewing or you had interviews with young Syrians, did the idea of committing extreme violent acts come into it? Because a lot of the time, yes, you can understand why young Syrians would join, but whether they had separated the idea of committing inhumane acts from actually joining the groups, or whether they had considered that they might actually come face to face with this. And my second question is to Anna, and I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on some of the livelihoods programs or work that you do specifically on women, if you have any. Thank you.
Good questions.
I think it's a bit of a mixed picture, really. There's some people who have a better knowledge about what's potentially waiting for them in terms of some people are going knowing that they're going to die and that they will be killing other people, and some don't seem to have the same same knowledge. It's really a bit mixed, but people didn't necessarily frame it in that way and didn't really seem to be going after the violence itself, but what that violence was a route to, which was all of the other things that we've just said, so like to be part of something bigger than them. It was kind of framing the being part of an extremist group as a moral duty. And so when you frame something in that way, it kind of takes what you say, you don't see it as humane, or you don't see it as extreme. It's just, and for those who are going of their own volition and not being coerced, it's a decision that you're making in an extreme set of circumstances. You know, this isn't like normal life, but it's become very normal. So decision-making processes in that context, I think, coming across from the research and what we know more broadly, there wasn't that sort of knowledge explicitly. Having said that, we have seen some examples where there's this trajectory where people become more extreme in their act, the more exposure that they have to these violent contexts. And I think anybody who's kind of worked on a similar conflict or has any sort of understanding of the psychology of violence and so on would accept that and see that quite clearly. For example, we had somebody participating in the research. It was a friend of somebody who has joined ISIS, but he didn't start there. He started off in a peaceful protest back in 2011. He was imprisoned by the regime and raped and tortured when he was in captivity. When that ordeal was over, he started his journey and he has joined armed groups, and he's eventually ended up with ISIS. And in a correspondence that this young person that one of our researchers spoke to, one of the correspondents he had with this person who's fighting with ISIS said, "The next time I see you, I will happily kill you." So there seems to be this journey that a lot of young Syrians are going, where there's this link between being brutalized and becoming, well, what we might term more radicalized and engaging in extremist violence. Does that answer the question?
No. Anna?
Yeah, we actually did some projects. We are still doing them with women. We are running a project in which we give a vocal training to women for knitting and cloth making, so sewing. What we need to be careful when we work with women inside Syria is trying to target the right beneficiaries. We don't want to create a conflict within the family where the man who is the breadwinner see her, the wife, to start a business and become the focal point of the family. So we need to balance the two things. If it's offered to the wife, it should be also offered to the man, or at least be balanced and not to move completely the focus from the husband to the wife. The other problem that we see sometimes is that we offer this program to widows, so the two women that don't have husband, and so they have to support their children, but obviously they also have to look after the children. So we try to combine the things of sending the children to school, and in the meantime the children are at school, you can join the vocal training, and then you can do your own activities at home. For example, knitting is something that the women can do in their houses when they look after the children. They don't need to go and work somewhere. And this is working. It's really trying to balance what time they have to develop their skills and what time they have to dedicate to children. But we see a lot of response in women that want to learn and to become self-sufficient and develop their skills and support their family.
Thank you for that.
And if I can, sorry. We are also, it's a new project, so I apologize if I don't know the details. We are also running now a project for gender protection. So we deal with women that have been abused. And we have a few centers where we give training that are similar to the children-friendly space, but the women-friendly space, where we give training to women to believe in themselves, develop their skills, talk about what happens, how to deal with the shame that sometimes they feel. So we have social worker and psychologists that deals with these women to try to help them to overcome their traumas.
Thank you. I did see a couple of hands at the back, two gentlemen at the back. I'm going to take them at the same time, if I may, but also please do continue to show hands.
Good evening. My name is Najib. I work for Open Doors International, so I work in grassroots advocacy in the Middle East and North Africa. And I have a question for you, Caroline. You were mentioning the different approaches that you see vital to reducing vulnerability, and I wonder if you have any indicators of how effective have they been. You mentioned a couple of examples, but I would value if you have any indicators of effectiveness, particularly within your scope of reach with the programming that you do in International Alert, and particularly as you mentioned the non-violent activism. I was wondering if the report shed light on any positive experiences been done in this field, or to give any sort of idea about helpful factors that would set up the appropriate framework for such activism to be done with vulnerable children or the people that you've done the research with.
Thank you. If you wouldn't mind just passing the mic directly to, that's it.
Thanks.
Thank you.
My name is Hassan. I'm from Syria, Damascus, and I also happen to be a refugee. First of all, I want to say, my question is to Caroline as well. I totally agree with you on the reasons of why young Syrians are joining extremist groups like Jabhat al-Nusra and ISIS. But don't you think it's fair to say that actually the failure of the United Nations and Western government in Syria is actually the bigger picture, and that's the reason why young Syrians have decided to join terrorist groups? Because you mentioned about meeting someone who was captured for peacefully protesting 2011. And if we are to understand the conflict, because it did start 2011 with peaceful protests, it went to forming something called the Free Syrian Army, which sadly hasn't received any support. And as you all know, Free Syrian Army is a group of people like you and me who decided to carry AK-47s and decided to fight Assad. That didn't happen. The world turned a blind eye on Syrians. And with two options, you either go on a dinghy to Greece or you get killed by Assad. Sadly, a lot of Syrians decided to join Jabhat al-Nusra and ISIS, which is wrong by any means. But I'm just wondering if the bigger picture, if we would zoom out a bit and say that it's actually the failure of the United Nations in Syria and turning a blind eye on Syrians caused that to happen and perpetuated the acts of ISIS and Jabhat al-Nusra. Thank you.
Other questions for you?
Right, thanks. I'll take the first question first. So in terms of indicators for success in terms of programming, so International Alert has a very sort of, implemented a very robust sort of monitoring and evaluation process through all of the projects that we were running. We were looking for certain things. We were measuring attitudes, behaviors, knowledges, and practices amongst the children that we were working with. So we would take a baseline at the beginning of the project, then we would have continual reflection sessions, capturing stories, capturing success stories, looking at where things having impact, working with the facilitators to monitor throughout the project, and then having an end-line evaluation. I will direct you all at this stage to the smaller leaflet that you have on your chairs, which has on it a link where you can go to see the content of all the programs that we've implemented, as well as the evaluation of their impact and the success stories. So indicators for success that we saw through the project were children who were once at the beginning of the project, not once, but at the beginning of the project when they first started, violent towards their siblings, towards their peers. Through involvement in the sessions, they became much less so. They started to adjust their behaviors, both in the home and also with their peers. Others would reflect on themselves in terms of what's happened to them in their lives and how they would like to move forward with their life. So we work with a lot of children who've come from areas that are under the control of ISIS and are now in, for example, in Urfa in southeast Turkey. A lot of them exhibited extremely shut down behaviors when they first come to the peace education sessions. They don't want to interact with any of their peers. They don't want to listen to music. They don't want to have any color around them. They don't want to be touched by anybody. It's a complete sort of shell-like. Through the course of the sessions, with the support that they receive, a lot of them are starting to sort of come out of their shells and be able to sort of deal with the experiences that they've seen and that they have lived under. Other examples we've seen in terms of the nonviolent activism, a good example of that would be the Building Bridges program that one of our partners runs, which is actually for an adult age group. They bring together people from all different parts of Syria, those who have been sort of more pro-regime and those who are in favor of the opposition movements, and they have encouraged, they put them together for a very intensive week in a place in southeast Turkey. So these people have applied to come on this workshop, so it's not like, you know, they're not just anybody, they're actually people who have leadership potential within their communities, but they're from extremely different communities, and they are brought together to see the conflict from through the other person's eyes, to see their own place within it and to understand what is driving it and what they can do as positive agents of change in their own communities. And so that's been a very successful program. It's been very interesting exchanges between these people who would otherwise never come across each other, let alone listen to one another's points of view. And so now they get the support from the organization that ran that work, or one of our partners, to implement similar activities in their communities, so community-based peace-building initiatives, stay in touch with one another through something as simple as WhatsApp and just coordinate and share what's happening in their lives. So I think that's one sort of key example, and there's others as well as in our peace education case study that we have. In terms of the second question about the bigger picture and is it not the failure of the UN turning a blind eye, I think it would be remiss of us not to zoom out and look at the bigger picture. There is no doubt that this conflict is driving the vulnerability to, it's war. This is what war does to people. The fact that the peace process at the sort of high political level is so slow and so faltering, I can't really add any more to that than what's sort of already sort of publicly available in the sort of public discourse on that. But I think that you're right to bring our attention to that bigger picture. This is an extremely difficult situation. The high-level political actors have their own sort of process that they're going through. Where we, as community-based actors, are sort of taking the initiative is to say, almost regardless of what is going on there, although we know it's essential for any sort of lasting peace, what can we do right here, right now, to sort of either lay the foundations, but also help people to deal with the right here and right now and make different choices? And if we're looking at what's sort of driving young Syrians, I'm not talking about foreign fighters or anything like this, but what's driving the ordinary young Syrian 14-year-old boy to join Jabhat al-Nusra, for example, if we can provide some structure in some way that it makes a different choice, are we not in some ways undermining the pull of those armed groups? But also, are we not also providing a way that person can be something constructive in his community when finally, whenever it happens, some peace does come? So that's where we're focusing. But I thank you for bringing us back to the bigger picture. I think you're right to do that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, please show your hands again. Okay, I'm trying not to be bird-like in my vision. There's a woman over there. I'm going to take a few questions in one go, if that's okay. There's also a gentleman sitting here patiently at the front. And there's a lady there with a pencil, so sorry. It worked though, didn't it? So let's have you three asking questions and then we'll have another round.
Hi, Fiorella Fronzi from working in community development in South London. Now, the question is for Anna, Amaf, and Caroline. What are the critics that you got from a different standpoint in Syria, local people?
Criticisms. Okay, can we just collect some questions? So this gentleman standing, sitting here at the front, please.
Thank you. Ed Utley, I'm a trustee of International Alert. I'd like to ask a naive question, and that is, what lessons do other Syrians draw, and what should we draw from the fact that Bashar al-Assad and his wife were models of people who enjoyed a bourgeois existence in West London, access to training and jobs, visits to galleries, all those good things, and then went back, and he has behaved tyrannically. Thank you.
And the lady in the middle row, please. No. Try again?
It is.
Perfect.
Hello. My name is Lola Aliaga. I work at Safer World, a conflict prevention NGO. And I was. My question is mostly for Anna and Caroline, I think. I was interested in hearing more about the kind of challenges that your organization, so your local staff and your local partners are facing on the ground. I mean, obviously, I can imagine it's a terribly challenging environment to work in, to operate in, and also that probably challenges vary from one specific place to another, as dynamics are different in different local areas, and also probably according to what different groups are in power in different places. And so I just wanted to basically hear a bit about your experience in terms of how your work is perceived and received and maybe challenged by some groups, and how you kind of navigate local dynamics in the places where you work.
Thanks. Okay. Just to say, we'll have a final round of questions, so I haven't forgotten the others with their hands up. Perhaps we could go start with you and then work our way along.
Okay, so when it goes to the critics and Assad, it goes on the same direction for me. So basically, Assad and his wife have been educated here in the UK or lived while here in the UK. But then when they went back to Syria, they went back to a regime that is 40 years old. This regime had problems with Syrian Kurds, Syrian Sunnis, Palestinians, Lebanese, had war against Israel, started a war with Turkey, was sending jihadists to Iraq, and then he jailed them when they went back and sent them again against Syrian people. The thing is, this is a regime that's corrupt from the ground. It's not based on Syrian society's social contract. I'm a fan of Rousseau, so I'm a fan of social contract. So it's not based on Syrian social contracts. It's a dictatorship that it's there, and Assad having a higher education here in the UK, it didn't affect, because after all, it didn't change his mentality. As a solution, what we are trying to do, because Assad represents a mentality that is in Syria, that for power we are ready to kill or fight or torture anyone. What we are trying to fight this mentality here in the UK through rethinking and rebuilding. We're trying to, because we can influence at least the Syrian community here in the UK to reform the Syrian social contract, to have somewhere where Syrians can basically practice their rights, they can criticize each other, they can build together a solution, and this is it. It doesn't really matter how long has he lived outside, and the Syrians, it doesn't really matter where are we if we don't build a real Syrian social contract. The critics is basically what the international community is trying to do is to reproduce the same system without solving the problem. So it's reoccurring problem if we don't solve it this way. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you. Anna.
In terms of Syria relief, I think, I can analyze your question more from a structural point of view and operational point of view on the ground. So Syria relief is an organization that is registered in the UK headquarters in Manchester, with offices in Turkey and 6 offices inside Syria. I guess what we have learned over the past 5 years is to not set up an organization that is a vertical control from top to bottom. We in the UK don't have to have the arrogance to control and to impose to our colleagues inside Syria what we want them to do to help the local people. We have to ask them what we can do to support them and how we can better address their needs. So what we have been trying to do over the past 4 years is to work on a horizontal level. We, the Turkish colleagues and the Syrian colleagues, addressing the problems at the same level without imposing what project we would like them to implement, but talking together, discussing what is needed, and then ask our donors to help us to respond to these needs. Because at the end, the need comes from the ground. It's not for the donors or for us to tell Syrian people we want to support a school. It's for them to tell us we need education. So, we are seen very local in Syria, Syria Relief, because as I said, we have local teams. Our staff in the UK is very limited, and our people in Turkey are mainly Syrians, and the people inside Syria are all Syrians. So we are seen from the local community as local, as a local organization, and this helps us also to have a very good connection with local communities, with groups that are in the local councils. So we are not seen as an international organization, but more as a local actor, I would say.
Thank you for that, Caroline.
I think the challenges and the criticisms, I can probably take them both together because they're sort of linked. So in terms of criticisms of the work, a bit of resistance and criticism from some of the families. They're sending their children to the centre. When the children first start going, in many cases, the parents haven't fully bought into the activities. Sometimes it's because the activities they see as not quite appropriate for their children, because there's a lot of play-based and theatre-based activities that go on as part of the psychosocial support and the entries into sort of trauma counselling and trauma healing. There's been some questioning amongst some parents about that. That it might not be suitable for their children. The way that is dealt with is this outreach with the families and the communities to explain what these activities are, and then they're sort of invited to come and be part of them as well. When they see the benefit that it has on their children, this perception has started to change in many cases. Another criticism, which is also a challenge, is talking about peace. And in a lot of cases, we're not talking about peace, and we don't call it peace education when our partners are working on the ground. You can't be talking about peace and the importance of non-violence for a child in Aleppo who that very afternoon is going to have a bomb dropped on in their neighborhood. It's a conflict. We would be adding to that internal conflict and that sense of sort of mental displacement of not quite knowing what's right and what's wrong and so on. And so in that situation, in Aleppo, for example, our partners are providing what they're terming psychological first aid. So it's basically providing that safe space, and something that Anna said, you know, where the teachers are going round to the flats and just providing that small piece of normality and routine. They're not talking about the big ideas. They're not talking about peace and what will happen next. They're just dealing with helping people cope from day to day. But that is important for resilience because it's creating that network of sort of trust and some sort of hope. And then when you start building in the livelihoods angle and the education angle, and that's how you sort of create the mesh, the, you know, the community-based sort of peace-building stuff that we're getting to. But we don't talk about it like that. You don't start there. Another sort of criticism slash challenge is the fact that a lot of the young people they have to earn a living for their families. A lot of them are put in the situation of being a breadwinner. And so for parents and wider families to buy into it, again, it sort of goes back to the first one and say, well, why would we send our child here when they need to be out earning a living? And so that's where that's what Anna was saying as well, is you actually working with people who are from that community, who know the issues that community is going with, and then you design the programming around that. Whilst we, you know, we can encourage people to stay in education, the reality of it is that some people can't. So we have sessions at different times of the day. There's ways to engage people sort of with more outreach. There's a program that works specifically with street children, for example. And as we go further in this program, we'll be integrating all of that learning and all of those things that we know people criticize or potentially don't buy into the project initially for. We're going to integrate that and refine that as we develop this program further.
And adding on this point, for example, we had cases of children that had to work to support the family. So when we face this situation, we try to work with the family and provide the family an alternative source of income, incentivizing them to send the children to school. We are in the process of organizing a project for street children, where we ask especially widows to send the children to school, and in school the children will receive food vouchers, clothes vouchers on a monthly basis, so that we can monitor the fact that the children keeps going to school, and then we can support the family. So we want to put the two things together. Obviously, we understand that without the child going to work, the family will not eat. So we need to balance the two things.
Thank you. Let's have a final round, unfortunately, of questions. There was a gentleman here in the middle, and let's see if we can take these. Yep, that's those two, the gentleman to your right and the woman behind him, and I think we're going to have to stop there with apologies to everybody else.
Hi, I'm Sammy. I'm in the creative design industry, so nothing to do with any of this, but it's just close to my heart, that's why I'm here. My question is, or it's more of a, I'd like you guys to share your opinion, I guess, about just kind of continuing on what Hassan said, the gentleman in the back, that, you know, we're the rhetoric of what's going on, the story of what happened, the political situation, intervention, all of this. How important do you think it is for you guys as people who are involved in the conflict somehow, trying to help and trying to, you know, ease the pain for some people, how important do you think it is for people like you to share the truth about what's going on? Because it's very easy for everyone to kind of get lost in the whole, oh, you know, people are trying to overthrow a dictator, which is definitely true, but it's a bit of a series of tug of war game between powers in the East and the West and different parties and figures. How important do you think it is to share the story and make sure it's as true as possible to people, especially here in the UK? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The gentleman right there, thank you.
I'm a member of the public with no affiliation. What does the panel think of the view that given the acknowledged corruption of the Assad regime, the huge loss of life in the civil war, and the ensuing huge refugee problem, that what is needed is that we press for a desirably coalition military intervention in Syria and Iraq to depose Assad, contain or stop the murderous activities of Daesh, with the view to stabilizing the country so that there can be progress to a normal civilized society, a resumption of normal civilized society. And within that aim, how would one manage the transition from, as has been described, Syrians joining these military factions for a source of income, to, on the other hand, more purposefully directed activity towards reverting to a civilized society.
Thanks very much. And to the woman directly behind, the final question, thank you.
Hi, I'm Jessica Field. I work for Save the Children and Manchester University, actually. And my question is for Caroline, and might bring it full circle, I suppose. I'm interested to hear more about what you intend to do with the report and the study's findings, because a key challenge I see to its uptake is the kind of political value in grossly oversimplifying the radicalization narrative to be one of Islamic fundamentalism. Are you intending to counter that narrative, or is the report and the study for kind of more programmatic advocacy? And if you are intending to counter it, how are you planning to use this study specifically?
Thanks very much. Well, I'm just going to go back this way, do a quick whip round, but also perhaps use any of the elements of those questions to also summarize for today. That would be great.
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay. Do you want me to
start? Yes.
I think I can probably take your question and your question, kind of merge the answer, because obviously I think it's vital that we give a voice to the Syrians that we're working with. That's why we're here, that's why we write this report, and that's why we're sort of so keen to talk about it. And what we hope to do with it in terms of like telling these truths and these experiences of these young Syrians and why they're making the decisions that they're doing is exactly to do what you just picked up on, which is to inform policy. It's to inform a more nuanced public discourse about the issue. And it is also to design better programs on the ground. So International Alert always starts from what is the root cause, what is the root drivers of these conflicts. And when I say conflicts, because we're talking about very specific and localized conflicts in many ways, although we have to set it in this wider picture. So I think for us, for International Alert, definitely we want to contribute everything that we've learned through the course of this project and also give a voice to our partners and the young Syrians that we're working for to do all of those things to, you know, inform public and policy and programming. I'm afraid I can't really speak in much detail to answer your question about a military intervention to oust Assad and what comes next. I think that's not really the, very important question, of course, but it's not really the level that we're looking at. So that sort of higher level political decision making and decisions on military intervention is not something I can really speak to or add anything of value to in terms of answering that one directly. Maybe Amaf or Anna might want to tackle that one, but.
Okay, but to be fair, this isn't really, I mean, it's a very good question, but in all fairness to our panel, it's not really the remit of the discussion. So Anna, let's move to you.
Yeah, I mean, I agree absolutely with what Caroline said. I think it's our responsibility to raise awareness. I mean, as Syria Relief, we try to give as much evidence as we can to what's happening inside Syria. We try to bring stories here and to describe what is the situation. I try to be part to as many advocacy groups as I can. We work in a number of besieged and hard to reach areas, and we have stories that we try to share. So we feel the responsibility not only to help on the ground, but also to try to bring information here and to make people understand what is really happening inside the country. Again, on the political level, it's also difficult for me to comment. I am conscious that unfortunately there is no humanitarian solution to a humanitarian crisis, but probably only a political solution to a humanitarian crisis. In our situation, we need to try to work where we can, where we have been given access to, and try to help civilians on the ground, every civilian in need from every party. And then the only thing we can do, as I said, is to try to bring awareness and to push as much as we can, because a more holistic and political solution is found.
Thank you.
Giving space for people to express themselves and say what's going on, we have a program called Voices from Syria, where Syrians living in the UK would go to university students and tell their stories, what happened to them and why they have left their home country. So we try to do that. It has to do more of with our advocacy department, but then we try to echo the voice, and we even try to echo the voice when it comes to controversial issues. So once the Kurdish problem started in Syria, we had a talk at our center with Kurdish about what's going on, tell me your opinion. I'm gonna listen to you, I'm gonna respect you, I'm not gonna be oppressing you in a way. We're not gonna repeat the regime. So we're letting people express themselves, and we have voices from Syria. About military or intervention or whatever it is, before that, if our banks stop advocating for Assad cousins while they are closing accounts for Syrian refugees in the country, that would be perfect. If our media, instead of concentrating on ISIS, which is killing 2% of victims in Syria, rather than concentrating on who is killing 95% in Syria, if we do that, it might lead to a solution better than military. I'm not a politician, I don't know about military, but I know that there's a lot of hypocrisy in the way that Syrian case is being dealt with.
Thank you so much. I know that there were more questions, and I'm sorry that we didn't get to them, but thank you all for joining us and being a part of this conversation. And please join me in thanking this excellent panel for all their information and analysis.